the resolution.
Thank you for the introduction. I'm not quite sure if I deserve all that. In any case, I'm extremely happy to be here. Pune, the Oxford of the East. Right? I used to call it Pune. I've been corrected 3 times yesterday, so today I'm not going to call it Pune. I received an email from Susan Raj and Maya Raj. Susan is wife of Prithvi Raj, and Maya is daughter of Prithvi Raj. She runs the paint cast now. They both sent their greetings and they were both wishing they were here. As I was talking about yesterday, and I've seen so many of experts here, eminent folks in pain management. There are more in India than the United States almost looks like. I was impressed by someone who said they started pain management in 1980. At least it must be my age, not older. So that is a long time coming. So, as I said yesterday, it is very important. This is a new specialty. So we don't want to die as infants. We want to really grow old and then die and leave the legacy to children and grandchildren. If we don't do it right, it is going to be a very dangerous path. So our success depends. Thus, as a new specialty, the clinical research and publications. That is what I was telling yesterday, and I'm repeating the same thing today, but also the ethical practice. It is good to be on cutting edge, but don't be the part of the cutting edge. And that is what I see the upcoming specialties. Instead of learning the basics, we really want to go to the top. So instead of specializing in simple interventional techniques, we are looking at endoscopic interventions, stem cells, DRG stimulation, so on and so forth, which really don't have that much evidence yet. So we have to work on something which has the evidence when we were talking about evidence-based medicine yesterday. So coming to the lecture, Dr. Raj, that is my disclaimer. She said most of the things. I do not have any conflicts of interest. So I come from a small town in Kentucky, in the United States, called Paducah. It is located between Possum Trot and Monkey's Eyebrow. So most people in the United States think that is funny. So there are a lot of specialties for this small town. One of them is ASIC headquarters is located in Paducah. But we also have a quilt show every year. And 500,000 people visit, come for the quilt show. That's the international quilt show, only one place in the world. But more importantly, on August 21st, we are going to have total solar eclipse. And we are distributing the shirts and eyeglasses, everything. It happens only once in 200 years or so. Now, I come from a small town called Bodanpartey, which had only up to the second grade when I was coming up. That is when my grandmother said, we needed to build a school here. I used to walk 2 miles to another town to finish my third grade, and after that, I finished fourth and fifth together in 1 year by walking these 2 miles. Then I went to a different school for sixth grade. That was in another town. After that, for ninth grade, I moved somewhere else, Hyderabad. So, since my grandmother wanted me to do this, I built a school on her name in India, and I built a college on my father's name. Now, from second grade, we have 12th grade. Is that 12th grade? Junior college is 12th grade. So we have produced a few doctors, lot of engineers, and many others. Several people have graduated. And this is the medical school I went to, the old one. And the new one looks totally different now. And we also built the Alumni Education Center. And there is an auditorium there. If you ever hold a meeting in Hyderabad, you can use that auditorium. So some of these things I've been saying yesterday, and probably I've written lots of times, so I'm going to repeat a few things. But as they said, everything has been said before, but since nobody listens, we have to keep going back and beginning all over again. That is true for pain management too. So about Dr. Raj, there is Susan and Prithvi Raj, very good friends of ours, and he is my mentor. I was never trained by him, we just became friends. The first time I met him was in 1977. I went to the United States in 76. At my first meeting, he was demonstrating a caudal epidural injection. So this this big guy, six feet 5 inches and 250 muscular American guy, was pushing the needle. And he said, "Well, this damn thing doesn't go in." So he said, "Doctor, our goal is to find the sacral hiatus and put the needle in there, not to make a sacral hiatus." So after that, I started walking. I was so impressed with him. That was my first year. I didn't know anything. And then he told me that you can go to anywhere you want to, so on and so forth. So I was impressed that he would talk to me. I was just a first year resident. So they came and visited. The one at the end is Dr. Raj, Dr. Rax, and then his wife, and Dr. Raj, Susan, and myself, right at my house. You can't see much, but I have lots of trees. He has achieved a lot. Somebody was saying yesterday he's a global man. That's true. It is just not limited to India or United States. It's global. Unfortunately, we lost him on last February. And then my grandmother and my mother and father, all of them are gone. So my grandmother's, I don't know if it was her dream or order or dictatorship, whatever it was, she told me that there were only two things in life. I can become either a doctor or a failure. Nothing in between. I couldn't believe that from a second grade school, and she had such a big ambitions, and I'm so glad I was able to fulfill that. And that is Dr. Ramarao. If there is somebody from Andhra Pradesh, they might know him. He was a professor of anesthesiology. I did the post-graduation in anesthesia, and he became the superintendent and principal of the, I think, called superintendent. And that Sita, a very popular obstetrician, she delivered babies for many of the actors. He passed away in December 2. So he's the one who kind of told me to learn about pain management when I was doing anesthesia. So creativity is thinking of new things. The title I made up for this is innovations, but now I'm worried that do we really need the innovation, we need the evolution. So let's talk about some differences between innovation and evolution. Innovation is key to the future, but basic research is the key to future innovation. Again, we go back to the same thing, research and publications. Those are the important aspects. The four pillars of success is evidence, consensus, compromise. We need to learn to compromise. This megalomania mentality should go down. We do need to compromise. Everybody has something to offer. Compromise is important. Then we also need to learn sacrifice. I always say that don't be AIG. AIG is the insurance company which American economy into bankruptcy in 2010 or 2007. So AIG means arrogance, ignorance, and greed. So please avoid those three things and you will be very good. So I will just discuss a little bit about evaluation of specialty of interventional pain management, advances, and evidence assessment. I think evidence assessment is one of the major achievements in interventional pain management in recent years. So this is how we evolved, of course. Evolution is the process of growth and development, change in one direction, adaption, progression, metamorphosis. You can have two types of innovations, incremental, is a small change or improvement, or a disruptive, which is a fundamental paradigm change. Which one do you want to choose? Disruptive can be very good, but it could be very dangerous. Probably incremental is very safe, unless you are as smart as Bill Gates or Zuckerberg, who knew how to retire at age 28, make a few billions without working. So if you can figure out that, the disruptive is a good thing. Incremental is better. Your strategy is that for an innovator, a person or organization is the first to do something new and often opens up a new arena to achieve an improvement upon the way things are done currently. So we heard some of the innovators from India, what they are doing. Even though we are from India, we haven't practiced here. Like, I practiced just general medicine for a year or so and went to the United States. So everything I know is US rather than here. As a visitor, I know a few things. Many ideas grow better when transplanted into another mind. That's evolution. Then the one where they sprang up, innovation. So innovators are always not the greatest thing. Evolution probably is a better thing. Looking at innovation or evolution, they were talking about who started the first clinic on May 10th or May 27th. So you go back to how the caudal epidural injections were started. In 1901, the Kathleen announced that he found and he thought he was the inventor, and he said he was the inventor. I mean, Sicker. So this is the guy. But Kathleen came and said, that's nonsense. I've been doing this long before you. The same thing happened to Ether. There were different people claiming superiority over the other person, and eventually only one person got the credit. For Ether, for Thomas Martin, it took an act of Congress, proper law. It took an act of Congress, United States, to decide who was the first one, actually. So coming to our interventional pain management, caudal was found in 1901, transforaminal 1952-53. That is when the steroids started to be used for back pain. Until then, it was only the local anesthetic. So we lived 51 years without any steroids. Then interlaminar didn't even come until 1966. Adhesiolysis came in 1989. There were different local anesthetics, cocaine, novocaine, lidocaine, bupivacaine, now ropivacaine. Again, you see the developments, but at the same time, you see increasing costs. Somebody is going to pay for that. Who is going to pay for that? Can patients afford to pay that? Insurance company pays it. But who is going to pay for it eventually? Ultimately, it's the patient. Their insurance is paying, that means they're making less money in their salary. Either way, it is going to be ultimately the patient. Now we have globalization. How did we globalize? Started with case reports. We say that case reports are not very good, but everything starts with case reports only. Now, journals don't even accept case reports anymore because it reduces their impact factor. that would have the same position, it would reduce our impact factor significantly. So we don't accept case reports, brief reports any longer. We focus mainly on randomized controlled trials, systematic reviews, and we do accept a few others. So we have to start a new journal called IPM Reports so we can publish just the case reports and brief reports. We have a lot of issues regarding utilization. I'm just hearing from different doctors here. Now, everybody, we talk about only good things here. You go to a neurosurgeon conference, you go to a spine conference, that's where you really hear bad things about pain doctors. They are going to criticize how horrible you are, why you don't even need to exist. And you look at the government issues, insurance companies, they are going to talk about how you are going to put needle in everyone for everything. The utilization explodes. We have to understand there are numerous controversies. So they say that you are too interventional if you are putting too many injections. They don't say that the radiologist who is doing all the x-rays, you are too radiological. And a cardiologist, they do say that if you are doing too many of those, but that is what an interventional cardiologist is for. Otherwise, you go to a non-invasive cardiologist. They don't have to do the CATs. We need to understand placebo, nocebo, and our addiction to steroids. We need to really limit and what type of steroids, why we use them. We have to develop an understanding for that. You all know that there is a black box warning in the United States about steroids into the epidural space. So this is the development of history of interventional techniques, like first caudal epidural to 1901, first CM plexus block, first epidurogram, sacral steroids in 1952 and 53. They did a lot of studies with high-volume caudal epidural injections with local anesthetic only. So this is the first pain drop in the world. So it is not Vanita, and it is not Dr. Roy. I wish he was, but he was not. So this was April 20, 1901 in Paris. He reported in a case report 9 cases, he managed with 4 sciatica, 2 low back pain, 2 syphilitic myelopathy. I don't know how it becomes 9, I must be missing one case there. All of them were relieved of pain, 14 days of recovery in 4 patients, all received with repeat injections, And he also invented the contrast durogram after that. So during World War I, he was labeled as pain doctor. So he's the first pain doctor in the world. And he's not an anesthesiologist, a neurologist. So Kaplan comes and says that he's a urologist, neurologist and urologist. He was the first pain doctor because he did these things. But he was using caudal for repair of hernia. And it was not working very well. Of course, caudal doesn't work too well to get hardly repair unless you put very high doses. He was the chief surgeon. So I don't think he's a pain doctor, so he's a surgeon. Going a little bit to the historical innovations of ether, Crawford Long was a surgeon. He did the first obstetric anesthesia with ether, so he became an obstetric anesthesiologist, even though he's a general surgeon. In 1842, but he never published it. There was no public demonstrations. In 1846, Green Martin did that, Thomas Green Martin. So he got credit. So when he got the credit, Jackson and Wells, they said, well, they did before that. But it so happens, all three of them visited Crawford Long and watched him doing these procedures. And they went back and announced it. Today is called plagiarism. You can go to jail for that. In those days, it was a research. So now there is a Crawford Long Dome in Boston, but it took an act of Congress to do that. And Crawford Long statue also is there in the halls of Congress in the United States. Every time I go there, I visit him, even though I'm no longer an anesthesiologist. So looking at interventional pain management, this is some of the developments. I was involved in this organization and everything in 1998, 1999. At that time, there was not even a definition of interventional pain management. So we wanted to have a designation and definition, and we came up with the definition, and there's a specialty designation for interventional pain management. So we kind of got this definition a little bit wider than too restricted to be needle jacks. We also have a definition for interventional pain management techniques. This is from MedPAC report in 2001. But it also includes not just the needle placement or radio frequency neurotomy ablation, laser or endoscopic discectomy, intrathecal infusion pumps, and spinal cord stimulators. So we were thinking in 2001, we submitted this definition in 2000 by the time it got approved. This was a study commissioned by Congress of the United States, by MedPAC. So we were thinking about the future. We were not even doing endoscopy discectomy at that time, but we thought someday we will do it, and it was a good thing we did, because most of our members want to do it now. The utilization I was talking about, there is a significant change how you are doing these procedures. In the United States, these procedures have increased all interventional techniques 153% per 100,000 population, Medicare population only, but it translates to other populations are even worse there. Annual growth rate of 6.9%. Your population growth rate in the United States is 0.2%. So we are in extremely explosive increases, just like an opioid epidemic. This is a kind of an explosive increase. But look at the change in dynamics. In 2000, 58% or 59% of the procedures were epidurals. In 2014, only 45%. There were only 29% of facet joint and SI joint interventions in 2000. And for 2014, 47%. So the dynamics are changing. Now, with the general statistics like that, you think that everything is increasing. But interlaminar epidural injections or hard epidural injections actually have decreased. From 2000 to 2014, we are doing less of that. What are we doing now? We are doing riskier procedures like transforaminal epidural injections. That is where FDA wanted to stop us from doing, but that is what is increasing now. So this shows how these interlaminar epidurals and transforaminal, like 73.7% of the procedures in 2000. This is in the United States. We're not talking about Bangladesh or Pakistan or India. This is United States, supposedly the most developed country. 74% of the procedures for lumbar epidural injections. Today, they're only 36%. Well, probably less, but in 2014. One of my friends called me one day, one of the Indian anesthesiologists, he wanted me to see a patient. I said, why? He said, well, I thought I was going to do a lumbar epidural on him, but it so happens his pain is in the chest wall. So the way he found out is he put the patient on the side and started doing that, and he prepped it and started putting the needle, and that lady said, sir, can you stop for a second? He said, okay. He stopped and said, you think if you put that needle there, it can help me high here in the chest? Oh, your pain is in the chest. So everybody was doing epidural injections for everything. So she comes to me, actually she didn't even need the epidural injection. She engineered in Prakash Narwal. After I evaluated himself, he's a board certified anesthesiologist but didn't have any pain training at all. And he did not have a pain rotation when he was in training, but he was practicing pain. That's what we need to avoid. The same thing goes with facet joints and radio frequency neurotomy. We are going for riskier procedures. Now a little bit about opioid epidemic. I made this statement about 4.6% of world population, United States was 4.6 when I made the statement in 2002, I testified in front of Congress. Now, US population has gone down to 4.4%. So we consume, United States consumed 69% of world supply of opioids, 99.7% of hydrocodone. See, you guys can't have anything. I told one of my patients, said, well, we are taking 99% of hydrocodone, we need to cut down on this. He said, well, there's still 1%, can't I have that? United States consumes 73.1% of world's oxycodone supply in 2014. We were talking about the deaths, how people are dying because of that. Look at it, where the deaths are. Natural synthetic opioids is only about 12,500 only, but it's a pretty big number. But the same number is attributed to heroin, which is present in India too. We don't know that, a lot of people don't know that it's heroin because when they die, you test them, only thing you find is morphine. And you blame it on morphine. And synthetic opioids, they come from China. They mix with heroin and these young kids are dead next morning. Those deaths are almost equal to opioid deaths. So we can't blame everything on prescription opioids. Now yesterday, Dr. Lakshmi was showing only 6% of the total prescriptions are written by pain doctors. 94% are written by all other doctors. Now, heroin deaths are more than gun homicides. You see so much about gun homicides in the United States, and I get on my Facebook all these people writing, why don't they control guns? Why don't they control guns? And everybody blames Trump for that. But he just became president 7 months ago. This has been going on for 250 years. Well, now we are reducing the use of opioids. We have reduced it by 18%. Can you believe that? We think that opioids don't work at all. That is what the literature shows. What do patients think? They actually do work in selected patients. They are very helpful in some of the patients if you select them properly. I'm not asking you to start this opioid epidemic in India, but they do work when you do that. So 57% of them say their life is better, their pain is better, they're able to work. So that is your indication. If you can give opioid to someone without changing their psychological profile, mentation, and they're able to work and function, I'm okay with that in low doses. And that is what you should do. How did we get into this opioid epidemic? In 1980, there was a letter to the editor. Now you know the power of the letter to the editor here. Just a small letter to the editor. They just stated that addiction rate in patients treated with narcotics based on post-operative pain patients. Based on that, the king of pain studied 38 patients and said opioids very effective, they do not cause addiction. Boy, pharmaceutical agencies, everybody took these things and they blew up everything. So I had a talk with him. He wanted me to come and speak at their meeting, but then he said I have to change my views. He thought I was pretty much a voodoo doctor because I was already criticizing this opioid epidemic in 2001, 2000. But that's when we introduced this bill called NASPRO to monitor the opioid use in different states. I wanted a national program. Didn't happen. Finally, we compromised. We have state programs in all the states. So we were successful in one way, but state medical boards, they said no disciplinary action will be taken against a practitioner based solely on the quantity or frequency of opioids prescribed. I told them the medical board when I was appointed to the board by the governor, I said, we need to take the sentence out of here. Oh, an entire membership of the board started lobbying how to get me off of the board. They have finally taken out now, but accrediting bodies, that stupid thing, vital sign, right to pay relief, promotion, organization, industry, misinterpretation of the evidence, works for me. Patients say that, physicians say that, my patients do well. So finally, the Joint Commission agreed that that was a stupid idea. I don't think it was stupid. I think it was galactically stupid. So we are spending a lot of money treating chronic pain for depressive disorder, every disorder. Look at these things. We are spending just on musculoskeletal disorders in the United States, $185 billion. Back and neck is included in that. Low back and neck pain. But why did we spend all this? Because we changed the standards. How much pain relief do you have to get? Is 10% okay? 20% okay? Now we are settled on 50%. So we have to spend more money to get that. So look at what happened to diabetes. Fasting sugar 140 was pretty good. And then they changed it to 146. What did it do? It increased. 14% of the population became more diabetic. Hypertension. 140 was okay, they changed it to 160. Say 160 was okay, they changed it to 140, and then 35% more people became hypertensive. Nothing changed. Hyperlipidemia, cholesterol. You see, that's one of the casualties of myself. My cholesterol was running 210. I thought I was doing pretty good. Suddenly I became hypercholesterol. Osteoporosis. Do you know that there's a difference between osteoporosis measurement in the United States compared to India? You do, okay, good deal. So this is your Indian joke. Your cholesterol has stayed the same, but research findings have changed. Now you have to take so many medications. So there are a lot of regulations in the United States, innovations and evolution of regulations. When President Obama came into power, he increased the regulations by 600%. Doctors spent 1 hour with the patient, 2.5 hours on the paperwork. We have fraud and abuse issues, anti-kickback statutes, stock law regulations, HIPAA, ACA. I used to spend a lot of time giving all these lectures. Now, like Dr. Correa, he showed this slide himself. He wants more opioids in India. Do we really want more opioids? You do? No. You ain't seen anything yet other than English. Look at that. You need to end cut practice in Indian healthcare. So look at some advances. We wrote an article on innovations in interventional pain management, neuroblockade, neuroablative procedures, spinal cord and peripheral nerve stimulation, intrathecal drug delivery systems, minimally invasive lumbar decompression, percutaneous endoscopic spinal decompression, regenerative medicine, and evidence synthesis. And most of the advances, I think, should be coming from the physical examination of the patient, touching the patient, examining the patient, establishing a bond with the patient. That should be our ritual. I think we are all forgetting that. The majority of the patients, when I took my father to the doctor, I was sitting with him, he never touched him. He reviewed his x-rays and everything and gave a diagnosis and told me that he needed a bronchoscopy. So things have changed. So forgotten essentials of physical examination. But major advances, mandatory fluoro. I teach your license. Now I know you guys are all interested in ultrasound. Don't go for ultrasound for spinal procedures. That is going to destroy your specialty. I teach your license. Technical advances in radio frequency, evidence development, life without steroids, research, publications. I'm like a broken record. I keep saying the same things over and over again. Neuromodulation has so many developments in software and hardware, stimulation patterns, high frequency bursts or adaptive combinations, whatever you want. Minimally invasive spinal decompression, percutaneous disc decompression, APLD, APLLD decompression, nucleoplasty, hydrodiscectomy, biaxioplasty, and mine for spinal stenosis. Probably this will be one of the least expensive and very safe procedures to the future. I'm trying to get this equipment down to $600. They're selling it $1,600 now. If they get it to $600, I think we all can use it. Regenerative medicine, platelet-rich plasma, stem cell implantation. Now, board certifications are very important. The Pain Medication Board came in 1992 in the United States. So that I was certified in 1992, the first year.